There are generally two methods for simulating digital circuits. One is more widely used, while the other is more precise. In this video, I want to discuss the more commonly used method. In this video, I'm going to explain how to simulate digital circuits using the ISIM software, which is part of the ISE Design Suite. ISIM is the simulator provided by Xilinx, and if you have the ISE software installed on your computer, this simulator is also installed alongside it. You can use it to simulate your circuits. Before diving into the simulation itself, let's talk a bit about the different types of simulation. When you want to simulate a digital circuit using one of these simulation tools, you generally have two types of simulation available to you. The first type is functional simulation, also known as behavioral simulation. And the second type is timing simulation. In functional simulation, your goal is to verify the logical behavior of your circuit. For example, if you've designed an adder, you want to check whether the addition operation is performed correctly or not. In functional simulation, all delays from operators and functions are considered to be zero. For example, if your circuit contains an AND gate, when one of the inputs to the gate changes, the result is propagated to the output in zero time. But in reality, that's not how things work. In practice, every electronic or digital component has what's called a propagation delay, which causes the effect of the input to appear at the output after some delay. For example, in the case of the AND gate, if you change one of its inputs, the output might change after, say, 1 nanosecond. This delay is called propagation delay. In timing simulation, these propagation delays are also taken into account. So, as you might guess, timing simulation is used for later stages of the design process, such as after synthesis, placement, or routing. Once you've completed synthesis, the actual components inside the FPGA are used for implementation, and each of these components has a propagation delay. In timing simulation, these propagation delays are also considered. For example, when simulating an AND gate, after changing the input, the output changes according to the propagation delay, which could vary depending on the FPGA you are using. It might be, for example, 1 nanosecond or some other value. Now, to explore simulation using the ISIM software, let's use an example. I'll use the same priority encoder example that we discussed in detail in the previous video. As you probably remember from the last video, an encoder determines its output based on which of its input is active. In the normal operation of an encoder, exactly one of the inputs should be 1 at any given time. However, if more than one input is 1, the encoder might not function correctly. That's why the priority encoder was introduced. In a priority encoder, if more than one input is 1, you can specify whether the priority should be given to the higher index bit or the lower index bit. For example, in this case, you see that inputs W1 and W3 are simultaneously 1. Now, if we say this is a priority encoder that assigns priority to the higher index bit, which is W3, then since W3 is 1, it's considered as the active input and W1 will be ignored. The output will then be determined accordingly. To simulate your circuit using VHDL in ISIM, the first thing you need to do is create a special file called a test bench. It's a special VHDL file where the VHDL module you've written is instantiated, and you can assign the desired values to the inputs of your module. Keep in mind that the test bench file is only used for simulation and cannot be implemented. Now let's move on to the software and see how we can simulate the priority encoder module we designed in the last video using ISIM. Here you can see the priority encoder that we discussed in detail in the previous video. If you have any question about this code, you can refer to the previous video to clarify them before you proceed with the simulation. To simulate this code, as I mentioned, you first need to create a testbench file. A testbench, as I mentioned earlier, is a VHDL file, but it's a specific type of VHDL file. To create it, go to the hierarchy section, right-click, and select New Source. Among the file types you can create, select VHDL testbench and give it a name. I personally have a convention for organizing my files and making them easier to access later. I name testbench files with the name of the module I want to simulate and add _tb at the end. For example, now the module I want to use is the encoder module. So I'll name the testbench file encoder_tb, where tb stands for testbench. Click Next, proceed to the next page, and here you'll be asked which of your module you want to create the testbench for. As you can see in the hierarchy section, there are several files in the project, but when creating a testbench, you can only select one module at a time. So here it's asking which module I want to create this testbench for, and we want to create it for the encoder module. So we select that and click Next, and finally click Finish. Now a testbench file has been created. I won't go into too much details about this file, but there is an important point to note here. The ISE software creates the testbench file assuming that you want to simulate a sequential circuit with a clock signal. As a result, it includes some lines related to the clock. If, like in this example, you only want to simulate a combinational circuit, you need to delete the lines related to the clock. These lines contain the word clock, so it's easy to find them. For example, here the word clock appears, so I'll delete this line. This section generates the system clock for the simulation, but since our system doesn't have any clock, we'll delete it as well. Now there is another part of the code here that we'll remove. After that, I'll save the file. As I mentioned, the testbench file instantiates your module, and you can assign values to the module's input. Our module only has one input, W, which consists of 4 bits because we are simulating a 4-to-2 priority encoder. Now we need to assign values to it. Where do we do that? If you scroll down in the testbench file, you'll see a section labeled Insert Stimulus here. This is where you specify the values for your inputs. So let's assign a value to W. I'll write W followed by a simple assignment operator. For example, I'll assign it the value 0110. This means W0 is 0, W1 is 1, W2 is 1, and W3 is 0. Since this priority encoder prioritizes the higher index bit, you can probably guess what the output will be. The highest index bit, that's 1, is bit number 2. So we expect the output to be the binary representation of 2. Now let's run the simulation and see if that's the case. After creating and saving the testbench file, to run the simulation, go to the Design section above the hierarchy, where you'll see two options, Implementation and Simulation. First, select Simulation for the simulation process. Here you'll see your test benches listed. Our test bench is encoder_tb. Click on it, and in the lower panel, you'll see the option to launch the ISim software. As I mentioned earlier, ISim is Xilinx simulation software, and if you've installed the ISE software, ISim is installed along with it on your computer. Now, before running the simulation, you can double-click on this behavioral check syntax option to ensure there are no syntax errors in your testbench code. Fortunately, there are no errors here. After that, you can double-check on Simulate Behavioral Model to launch ISim software from within ISE. Well, this software you're seeing is ISim, and this section is the part that shows the signals. Since we are simulating a priority encoder, we have a 4-bit input W and a 2-bit output Y. Here you can see the input value 0110 that we assigned in the test bench. As expected, the output is the binary representation of 2, which you can see here. By default, ISim simulates for a duration of 1 microsecond each time you launch it. You can see that the simulation ends at the 1 microsecond mark. Initially, the simulation might not be fully visible on the screen, but you can click the Zoom to Full View icon to view the entire simulation from 0 to 1 microsecond. If you want to run the simulation for a longer time, you can specify the desired duration here. For example, I'll set it to 2 microseconds, then click the Run for the time specified on the toolbar icon to extend the simulation by 2 microseconds. Now the simulation runs up to 3 microseconds. To view the entire simulation again, click the Zoom to Full View icon to see the simulation from 0 to 3 microseconds. If you want to zoom in on a specific section, you can click on it to place a cursor there and use the Zoom In option. Each click will enlarge that section further. Now, you might wonder what to do if you want to change the input. One way is to go back to the ISE software and assign a new input value in the test bench. For example, let's change W to 1001. In this case, we expect the output to be 3 because the highest index bit, that's 1, is bit 3. However, we can't write two consecutive assignments without a time gap because only the last one will be considered. We need to introduce a delay between these two, which we can do using the wait for statement. For example, I'll copy this line, paste it here, and add a wait for 50 nanoseconds statement between the two assignments. This means that after assigning W the value 0110, we'll wait 50 nanoseconds before changing it to 1001. As you can see, there is also a default 100 nanosecond delay at the start of the simulation, during which the input is 0. After 100 nanoseconds, the input changes to 0110, and then 50 nanoseconds later, it changes to 1001. Now let's save the updated test bench file and return to the simulator. Here you can click the Relaunch button to rerun the simulation with the updated test bench. Now the simulation runs for 1 microsecond, and you can clearly see the changes. I'm using this cursor. Wherever I click, the cursor appears. You can click on any point in time to view the exact signal values. As specified in the test bench code, the input was 0 for the first 100 nanoseconds. Then, at 100 nanoseconds, it changed to 0110. Now, if we want to see exactly what the content is, we can make this a bit larger to see better. After 100 nanoseconds, we change the input to 0110 with an output of 2. After 50 nanoseconds, at the 150 nanosecond mark, the input changed to 1001, and as expected, the output becomes 3. As you can see, working with this software is very straightforward, and it allows you to perform various types of simulations for your circuits. The features provided by this software make it easy to test and verify the behavior of the module you've designed. I hope this video has been helpful and that you'll be able to use it to simulate your circuit effectively. If you enjoyed this video, please give it a like and share it with your friends. Thank you for watching. I'm Ahmad Saghafi, and I'll see you in the next one.